Giri, I am in. I'm just checking if Divya has come in. Just a second.
Yeah, this is Nagamani. Just 1 second. The next session will be live within another 2 minutes.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Yeah, we are live now.
Okay.
Hello, sir.
Hi, Divya. Yes,
hi, sir. Yeah, sir, 1 minute, sir. Actually, today, the first session, a small session is given by RP regarding how to access a virtual tomb.
Okay.
And that's a only 5 minute session. She is going to give that, and after that, I'm going to take over the session.
Fine, great.
She is on time.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Just 2 minutes, sir. She's getting getting into the system once again. I just checked with her. Hello.
Hi, Divya. Okay, great. So we are already live in YouTube. So we are starting the session.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Welcoming you all to the 40th session of Drug Discovery Hackathon training program. And as usual, Vertical 3 is focusing on practical sessions on open and proprietary software. Today we have a session from BioVia. From 7 to 8 p.m. And myself, Giri, one of the coordinators for Drug Discovery Hackathon. Kindly do not share any of your personal details in the chat during this meeting. And virtual tool room registrations are active. We have received your details. Please be patient. We will be soon getting back to you on more details on how to access the tools. And kindly type your questions in the live chat. And this is how the form looks like for the form for registering for the licensing and virtual tool room. So today we have a session on profiling ligands pharmacophore by Divya. But before that, there is Aarti from Altum Technologies, of course, BioVia's partner, who will be going to give an overview about how to access the CDAC resources for BioVia tools. Over to you, Aarti. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
You can share your screen.
Yeah. Is it visible now?
It's coming up.
Yeah.
Yes, it is visible. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Today I'm going to discuss how to access BioVia Discovery Studio in CDAC Virtual Tool Room. Myself, Dr. Aarti Vengatesan, currently working as scientific specialist in Altum Technologies, which is partnered with the BioVia Discovery Studio. And how to download the software? You have to go to discover.dds.com, BioVia Discovery Studio for DDH 2020. So once you have given this link, you'll be redirected to this page. And here you have to enter your email ID. Once you have entered your email ID, you'll be directed to this page. And if you are using Windows software, you will get Windows exe file, and based on your system configuration, you can download your exe file, whether it is Windows or Linux. So once you have downloaded your file, just click on your exe file. Then there is an installation process. It will take only 2 to 4 minutes. So once you have installed it, so hardly it will take just 2 minutes. Thank you. So once the process is over, you have to click the finish icon, then go to Windows and click on BioVia folder, and there you will find an option for BioVia license administrator. Just click on it, go to more option, run as administrator, and edit your option. Give your home. Server. If you just click on OK only, then one second. Yeah. You have to give your .cdac.in host name. Once it is done, you will be directed to BioVia Discovery Studio client page. Then you have to give your server name, servername.cdac.in, then test your server. So once it is done, just click on it. So it has been connected with the server here. So once it is connected, then only you can understand it has been connected to the CDAC server. Then go to View Explorer. Click on files. Once you have opened files, it will be directed to the file folder. Then you have to give your jobs folder. So once then it has then if you want to give your protocol folder, it will come. So after that, just go to files. If you have some protein, you can open it, or else you just go to the sample files. We have already done some files, so just go to simulation, and I'm just opening a protein file for energy minimization. I have just click on run simulation and minimization. So here I just clicked on run simulation part, and here I'm entering CPU name. The reason why we are running this process, we have to test whether we are connected to the CDAC server. And just if you have any minimization constraint file, you can click on to that, and the processor, number of processes, you can give it as 10, then run the file. Once it is done, you can run the file. So just click on to background, then it will be in the jobs explorer file. We shall just wait for 2 minutes. So this is again a testing process. So we just want to know whether it is connected to the server. That is the reason we are giving it here. So once it is done, just the minimization has completed. Then you have to click on your folder for. Ensure the client has installed to the server. Remaining things has been carried out by here. Yeah.
Yes, thank you, Aarti. Aarti, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Okay, now I'm going to start my session. And if anyone have any issues how to connect the CDAC virtual tool room, I hope we are given a very brief explanations, and to even in the next sessions also we are going to show the same, because a user has to get benefited out of it, how to actual the virtual tool room, and especially if you want to access the Discovery Studio, and these are the steps has to be followed and to ensure how to run the protocols. So today I'm here to take up the sessions for ligand profiling, and also I'm going to take up for an ADM meeting analysis also. So let us work on slides and get more details about how to do structure-based pharmacophore modeling and validation, and also I'm going to show you the multiple drug target screenings. So today we are going to see the drug profiler and ADMET and TopCat screening in Discovery Studio. So about your Altum. Altum as a company is a partner company of Dashal Systems, has headquarters in Bangalore and various offices across the country. And these are our partial customer list. So getting into directly how to create database. Today we are going to see how to create a database, how to screen your molecules with a different, we have one particular pharmacophore, it is very easy to screen the molecules and get it done. And even you can compare which compound is fitting to one particular pharmacophore. However, if you have a multiple pharmacophores or a more number of database of ligands, and how to handle this big data analysis and how to screen it. So we know that usually what we'll be following in a classical method, we'll be taking a list of compounds and then we identify the drug targets, and then defining drug targets we'll be going for docking, and then we are coming out with the results, seeing which is score based on scoring functions we are going to it. This is actually the complementary or a different way of thinking in a drug discovery process, which I'm going to discuss it today. First of all, we have to create multi-conformation ligand databases. What is the difference in the commercial usual databases and multi-conformation ligand databases? And if you take any databases which you download from a publicly available database, or you will be building a database, usually what we have, you will have only one conformation of your ligand, and then you'll screen with that, and then you'll be getting your results. So think about it. We already spoken about the conformation generation in previous sessions and importance of this conformations in docking also. So if you have multiple conformations, it also suits and fits even to the pharmacophores also. So if you have more than one conformation of a ligand, we should know which conformation it suits for your exact binding site. That's why we are building a database with a multi conformations. So what are the tools we are going to basically use that? Discovery Studio is a sophisticated tools and Versalite for building these kinds of an analysis. So we are basically using a catalyst to generate the ligand database, and the database will be automatically indexed within a substructure, pharmacophore features and shape informations in your search study database. This is how we'll be having, if you have a list of compounds, maybe a 1 lakh or 2 lakh or any count of compounds, you have to load in terms of an SD format or CDX format or any kind of a chemical structure formats has been supported by Discovery Studio. You can open and you can browse and how to build a library. I previously discussed in previous training sessions also, you can very well look into it and you have to create a libraries. Once you're done with a list of compounds in your molecular window, you have to take it to a protocol called Build3D Database. So Build3D Database, where you'll be inputting your compounds and giving a number of conformations. You could see that one molecule is likely to go under the 255 conformations with a method called FAST. Why we are using FAST and all, we discussed in a conformation generation analysis. Please kindly look into that particular video and gain more knowledge about it. So once you're done with the Build3D database, and automatically what will happen, this database will be integrated inside the Discovery Studio. So far in Discovery Studio, you can see these databases, drug like does diverse, containing about approximately 5,000 molecules, mini-mabridge, sample, and the compounds from an PDB database. However, if you like to screen within a user-specific database with the multi-conformations, you are supposed to go within a Build3D databases. And automatically, once you're done with that process, it will update it in your Search3D database. You can see here in COVID, 4,600 molecules has been inputted, and we are going to use the same molecule for our analysis. Now, getting into the concept of a structure-based pharmacophores, if you want to do the ligand profiling, what is required? We need the structure-based pharmacophore. In your previous session, I have briefly given a detail about ligand-based pharmacophore and quantitative and qualitative analysis and all. So here we are basically going to stick towards the proteins. What is a protein? Usually we'll be going for a ligands and pharmacophore is generating and we are going to get the results. But here it is quite differently, not I could say that quite differently. It is a different perspective of thinking about a concept of a drug discovery process. So structure-based pharmacophore method, it basically uses a either known or a suspected active site of the protein to the compounds, they are likely to bind at a particular site. And it could be a complementary method to your docking. So in a docking, we'll be finding the sites. Only the site will be defined, not the pharmacophore. Here we are adding one more parameter, it's called pharmacophore. So what it will happen, it utilizes the knowledge of your protein active site where your compounds will go and bind. And it maximizes the uses of binding information. You will come to know here which atom is going to act as an acceptor or a donor or a hydrophobic, or what is a site of protein pharmacophores are there. You could able to identify even the amino acid pharmacophore also. Which amino acid at a particular site is acting as a pharmacophore? What is the nature of it? All those things are integrated into a technique called a structure-based pharmacophore technique. So what are the protocols we are going to basically use? We have a protocol called interaction generation that will help us to identify the protein active site pharmacophore. And what are the tools we are going to see today? So we are going to basically stick on to the protein reports and binding site and edit and cluster pharmacophores. So this is actually the overall workflow of structure-based pharmacophore generation, where you have to define the protein. Once you define your protein, you have to create the interaction map that will be taken care by your interaction pharmacophore generation. Once you're done with an interaction map, you'll be going to edit because you'll be clustered with a lot of features. We don't know which feature exactly goes with an active site. So we are going to analyze and we are going to do it automatically using edit and cluster select features. Once you're done with that process, we are going to screen your compounds libraries. We have n number of compounds. Which compounds will actually go and fit to the particular pharmacophore? We are going to screen with the libraries. Once you get to that, we'll end up with a very good heat map analysis. That heat map analysis will tell us which compound is best for different drug targets. One compound for multiple drug targets and multiple compounds for a single drug target. You can access it either way. And you can identify the potential pharmacophore features. How to define the protein active site? You can see either even we have defined when you do the docking process in a molecular dynamic and simulation based docking or in a LibDoc or hotspots based docking, we are given more information about how to define a protein active site. However, I'm going to see little information over here. So once you have protein, you can define the site. We have to define the site. Once the site is defined, either bound ligand or maybe the binding site residues could be your active site. Once you're done with that, you have the tools under the receptor ligand interaction. First, you have to define a receptor and then find the cavities. Once you find the cavities, if you like to know about the coordinations, you can right click and you can get the XYZ coordination and the radius of your sphere. And once you're done with the process, that output has been taken as an input for your enumerating pharmacophores. Once your pharmacophores, how do you create it? Input your receptor and automatically it will take the site sphere. So what is a site sphere? X, Y is the direction of it and then your respective radius. And with this particular site sphere, using a Lewy interaction analysis, it will give you the best pharmacophore within your active site. So it will create a pharmacophore into your receptor active site, which consists, it could be on any features, acceptor or donor or hydrophobic features. Once you create that, you have end up with a cluster of pharmacophores. And how to do that? See, if you have more clusters, you can see a lot of clusters are there. Which one I need to pick it, whether it is a first one or it is directing the vector towards a right hand side or a left hand side or towards upside down or downside up, which I have to pick. We have a tools in the edit and cluster features in the pharmacophores which guide you and help you to identify which features you have to take, which cluster centers we have to take. So you can see here we have another pharmacophore, we have cluster and edit pharmacophore features, and for all the features you can either hide or you can see it in a 3D window and you can fix it out which pharmacophore is very important. So this special features will help you to identify automatically. Optionally, you can modify manually also, or else it's better you keep the cluster centers or by creating a manual selections. Once you're done with it, every time you'll be having this once you have on a clusters, when you speak about a clusters, definitely there comes into show of dendrogram diagrams. So this dendrogram diagrams will help you to identify the what are the cluster features. It is same like how we'll be classifying the clades of your proteins or from evolutionary analysis. Similarly, there are some clusters are put together in your same distances. All put together will forms in a one particular clade. Again, the subdivisions will be happening, and then you'll be getting root. From the root, you'll be getting a branches. From the root, sub branches will be there. So either way, you can see it in your diagram, phylogram diagram, or rectangular cladogram diagram, or even your slant cladogram diagram. So these options will be activated only when you right click and activate the cladogram tools. Once you're done with this, next we have to add in a excluded volumes to represent your protein structure. It is one of the important parameter which you have to done before doing the process, because this process will help us to identify the what are the site residues. Let me say that if you have an structures, you editing your pharmacophores or plays a major role. You identify the what are the important features are there. You know these are the important features which has to be play a major role, and other features I'm not interested. So you know that which features which for a particular amino acid or in a size which is having an important role. So finally, you need to edit the pharmacophores, and we have to give an exclusion features by introducing a constraints. So that also I'm going to show you now how to introduce all those things. Once you're done with it, you will be a particular pharmacophore for a certain receptor site or an active site is ready. If you're done with that process, you can take it further analysis with a screening of your compounds. This is an example. Since we are dealing with a SARS-CoV-2, it is most important. You have taken a drug targets information from a SARS-CoV-2 NST1. It is a very important protein. It is a major virulence factor protein of a SARS-CoV-2, and which is expressed in a host gene expression by ribosome associations. And this also facilitates the gene expression in infected cells and evasion from your human host responses. So this is how I have taken the NST1. And then I define the site. Once I define the site, I know the what are the amino acids. So these informations we have to collect from the literature reviews, and where the sites of binding or where the exact molecular mechanism is happening or what are the residues are important for your biological activity. You need to identify the literature reviews, and then you have to find that the site as a crucial for your pharmacophore screening. So you can see here I have chosen the 4 different amino acids, and you can see this is the vector features towards this is a accept donor feature that is towards here, and then this is here all are donor features and some hydrophobic pose also I can able to see here. By using the same methodology, how to create it, I created for a 3CL Pro. It's a main protease of SARS-CoV-2, and then the PL Pro and envelope protein, which is modeled in Discovery Studio, and then 6NUR is a RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. It's a very important enzyme for your replication process in SARS-CoV-2. So I shown here for 5 different things, but however, we are taking almost 17 different drug targets from SARS-CoV-2 for screening for an almost 4,500 approximate molecules. Of course, when you're done with any kind of pharmacophore, it is necessary we should know about validations. So how do you statistically validate your pharmacophore? Let me say for an instance, if it is a SARS-CoV-2, if you have an decoy sets, you can very well take the decoy sets and we can go ahead. So if for an example, I am giving a calculation about there are 25 active inhibitors of drug targets are there, and 2,073 inactive molecules are there. And how do I do that? I'm going to calculate the enrichment factor and goodness of fit by using a simple formula calculations. So we either you have an enrichment factor, HA is the total number of actives in a hit list, and HD is the number of compounds retrieved from databases, and A is the total number of active compounds, and D is the total number of compounds in database. And you have to make a tablet column like this that will help you to identify the percentage of actives, percentage of ratio of actives and enrichment factor, and also you can know about false negatives and false positives and goodness of fit. This will help us to validate your pharmacophore. Especially, you need to carry out this process for each and every structurally built pharmacophores. Now we have an multiple drug targets are there, because in SARS-CoV-2 we have a number of many number of drug targets, and we are created in a multiple pharmacophores, and we have in multiple compounds. How to handle this particular problem statement, or in this kind one kind of a technique, how to handle this if you end up with a multiple, if you have one drug target, one pharmacophore, and four or five compounds, it is very easy for us to identify and draw the conclusion. But think about it, if you end up with a large number of drug targets and large number of pharmacophores and multiple and a big data compounds, we introducing this, we simply call as a triple M model. How to handle this? In Discovery Studio, we have a wonderful tool which helps us to solve this technique. It's called Ligand Profiler. This Ligand Profiler is a very good tool, will help us to identify the multi-triple M model identification in any kind of problem statements. We can widely use this problem statement and to solve this triple M model into SARS-CoV-2. So what we'll be gaining? We'll be gaining insight possible side effects and toxicity of metabolic pathways. And we need to understand the drug characteristics and environment before proceeding this. We need to check it out, what are the high throughput screening results for non-selective inhibitors, and to draw the conclusion about the therapeutic drug targets for natural products and repurposing of existing drugs. If you have these kinds of issues, and you can very well go ahead with a Ligand Profiler. So you know that developing a drug, it's not an easy process. It requires a lot of money and then manpower, and even the time has to be spent. But when we get into the technique called Ligand Profiler, it automatically saves your time, and it's also cost effective. Powerful tool. So what is this tool? It's to says that if you have a biological problem, you have a select drug target, limited information about specific. It is a time consuming. Of course, I said in the previous things. So time consuming and low return, and you will be get up with a guessing of works. And we also, if you get into the chemistrical part, generate a pharmacophore and hypothesis and screening, and it just becomes a costly when we get into high throughput screening and synthesis also. And however, finally, if you get a low success rate, the problem ends with a failure. This is a classical modeling. Ligand profiling. How this tool is going to help us? You are going to introduce a known activity, or it will be end up with a low cost, and it is going to match your pharmacophores. So rather than amino acids, it is going to match with the pharmacophores, and you can map the multiple targets so that you can avoid the toxicity, side effects, and identify the alternative targets. You're not going to screen with the one target, you are going to screen with the multiple targets, and we have a high value outcome. This is a classical screening approach, and you have a single protein is selected, and millions of real or virtual molecules are screened, and linear evaluation of compounds is always a time consuming. Results obtained after screening can be for a specific compounds. Then it's a classical profiling, so you can check it out, the moderately active or inactive molecules, or what are the molecules, which compound it's not going well for another drug targets. So single ligand, it's selected against the thousands of real or virtual protein targets. So you can see here multiple compounds for one targets, or multiple drug targets for some compounds. So put together, we can have the how to proceed it. So Ligand Profiler is the best way. We are combining both the techniques into a single technique called Ligand Profiler. It is actually a quick and easily tested for all geometries of your ligands against the pharmacophore representation. Especially you're going to give a protein binding site. And it, of course, protein binding site is a high value information for your ligands to go and bind. We have tested this program with a lakhs of ligands, about 2,000 different protein binding sites, and rapidly screens of millions of ligands against the thousands of proteins, and we identify the what are the initial drug targets and what are the compounds will we go for the specific drug targets. And this is a study we have done for here, and this is the positive control, and these are protein classes and negative control. The negative positive control will accurately predict the corresponding incubators, and negative control will discriminate the matching ligands from the others. You can see in this particular heat map analysis, we are done for Navier's variant protein classes with the known incubators and validated this protein steps. Additional information, so you'll be getting a vertical highlights of promiscuous incubators and horizontally shows of poor models. You can see very well here. So what are the features of ligand profiling solutions of? So ligand profiler will help us for data analysis for database creation, and is a powerful and easy tool for data analysis tools and building a profiling database for in-house data sets also. And you can approximately at the time you can run around 2000 structural pharmacophores with a 50% shape descriptors and almost covers 200 drug targets. And there's a highly relevant therapeutic areas, and it will be applicable mostly. You can apply this technique in a drug discovery process to accelerate your research. And you can collect the compounds from a selected data, PDB literature, PDB database, or in structural databases, or even from the literature surveys. And what are the benefits? Of course, there will be a lot of advantages and benefits of using ligand profiler. And you have a leverage of prior biological to focus the development and advancement of data analysis and mining tools, and it will help us to identify the potential side effects or toxicity of compounds and co-development of targets. And you one can generate a library of compounds before synthesizing it. And we also we no need to waste your time on a false positives. And it also identifies a poor structure-based pharmacophore model and ranks and predicts and use for an individual drug target proteins. So now we actually get into demonstration. I'm going to show you how to build a database and protein preparation and interaction generation and editing cluster pharmacophores and finally the ligand profiler. Let's start. You can see here I'm going to build a database now. So just I built the databases which I'm used previously in DDH sessions, Indian traditional medicine database for antiviral compounds, nucleotide analogs and quinoline analogs. All put together, I'm going to screen for different multiple drug targets of SARS-CoV-2. So you can see here, once it is getting loaded, quinoline analogs, I'm loading up quinoline analogs. So you can see the molecules are loaded now. So I'm building the database. You can go to pharmacophore, build 3D database, and give a name of the database. And then you can have an excluding. If there is an existing confirmations, you can give true. And if you want for only one user, you can give one user, or it will be available for all the users, you can give all the users. And then give run. You can see the process is running and we'll be getting the results. And we will get the results like this. You get the number of molecules and the number of confirmation chain about 57,641. 5,76,000 confirmations are generated within a short period of time, and we're getting all the information regarding how many compounds you have taken and then database file location. If you are new to this, you can see the file location where it is actually located. And now you can open the search database. Now it is a part of your Discovery Studio search database. So 4,610 molecules are now part of it. So now we are done with the building of your database. It's ready for screening your libraries. Now we are going to concentrate on your structure-based pharmacophore modeling. So I download a structure, 6-RU. It's a main protease enzyme. And it is bound with a drug target, bound with a drug. If you want, you can check it in a protein report. And if you see here, what is this various data information? We explained more about this protein report in a previous session. Please watch there. And affinity confirmers and missing residues. And you can see here, this is SARS-CoV-2 main protease bound with the incubator. drug methenabosilaprevir and enclose your protein report. And I'm preparing this protein. So there is no role for water molecule here. I'm deleting water molecule. If there is no water molecule because of major role in active site, you have to consider those water molecule has a pharmacophore, because water is also a kind of a pharmacophore that has to be taken in account when you're going for a structure-based pharmacophore modeling and even for docking also. So once you're done with the prepared proteins, so click OK. So prepared protein results are ready now. I'm going to go for an interaction generations. So I'm selecting the bound ligand. This is a one bound ligand. And we can see this highlighted in 3D window. So go to receptor ligand interaction, define the receptor, and then from the select your drug molecule. And then current selection. So let us, if you have a drug molecule, it is easy to identify and you can do the work. And what about if we don't have any drug targets and what you have to do that? So I'm going to explain you shortly and do the interaction generation. So once it runs, I will explain to you. So alternatively, yesterday we did a protein-protein docking and identify the interface residues. Those interface residues are very important for your binding within a host proteins. You can block and identify those residues and you can generate an interaction map in case if you don't have an information about an bound ligands. So you get a pharmacophore features. We have a lot of pharmacophore features. It is a task to identify which pharmacophore features has to be taken. And we have a Luddy interaction, because it uses Luddy interaction analysis. So Luddy interaction map will be generated, has like an LibDoc analysis. So click here to view your results. So you can see there's a clumps on the lot of features has been generated in the protein active site. I'm zooming in. You can see the site and automatically the query route will be updated for acceptors. See a lot of acceptors, a lot of donors are there and hydrophobes are there. So which one I have to select, which is appropriately has to select it for this process. That's what we are going to see now. We are going to basically use a technique called editing pharmacophores, editing cluster pharmacophores. Select all the features and hide the location spheres. It gives you a view about what are the vector features are there and what are the point features are present in your active site. So green, basically green for an acceptor and pink for a donut. Now I'm selecting only the acceptors. And you can see the acceptor 85 I'm selecting. It is towards and it is towards the active site. And if you zoom in and you can see the clusters, if I click the donor, you can see the only the donors. If I hide the donors, it will be hided. If I select one second, it will be shown in 3D window. And you can see the how these donors are binding to the hydrogen OH atoms. And I'm opening here and creating a cluster features. Once I cluster features, you can see when I zoom vertically, as I keep moving on the slider, you can see that there is a cluster centers are highlighted based on the distance geometry and all in the features to create a dendrogram diagram. You may still consider representatives of groups which is not highlighted. We want to increase the size of clusters and cluster centers to highlight more than one representatives also can be done. Once I select it, you can see the group of clusters put together. Keep only the cluster centers. I'm going to keep only cluster centers. That will help us be to keep only the clusters centers of this particular features. And you can see it in a weather way in a dendrogram diagrams and what are the cluster features are there put together in the same distance and how the differentiations are there. Either way, you can interpret and you can see new results. Is a different representation. So once you keep and select, there are only a cluster centers will be there. So you can see the how well you can, we have clumps of data are there. You now selected only the cluster centers to be represented. Similarly for, I have going to repeat the same for acceptors, even for hydrophobic, how many features it is generated. You need to repeat the same for all the features. If the features is not towards your active site, you can delete it. And I'm going to repeat for hydrophobes. See, you can see the lot of hydrophobes. Again, the cluster centers. Again, you can draw vertically and you can see the cluster centers. Keep only the cluster centers and then you proceed with your work pharmacophore. Finally, I identified the these are the important structural pharmacophores for your work analysis. Now, once you're done with this process, I told you that the next process is to last step is to edit the structural pharmacophore to add excluded volume to represent the steric aspect of your protein. You can do it manually or you can do it here. So you go to edit, select and replace amino acid and radius within your 2 angstroms and apply. And then click OK, close it. Again, you go back to edit and then select it and then add by means of an, you can create by insert chains by amino acid or an atom. Here it comes to an atom, previously amino acids, and select a property equals to an atom and then click apply and okay, close it. And once you're done with that, you have to go to create pharmacophore manually and give the exclusion constraint. So once you give exclusion constraint, it will be highlighted there. You can able to see that. And these are the pharmacophore which is created for an particular 6-ZRU is a main protease. Now my pharmacophore is ready for screening with the series of ligands or database of ligands. How do I export and take it off? Just I'm changing the for better representation to show you the structure-based pharmacophore. Apply and OK. You can see here at the active site, you have selected the features and then you define your site. Now I'm copying the query route. Go to file, new molecule window and pasting it. And then you paste. You have the query root underscore 3CLPro, apply and OK. So similarly, I created for all different targets of SARS-CoV-2, RDPB, and then 6MOJ and NSP1 and NSP2 like that. I have created for different kinds of proteins. Structural pharmacophores, NSP13, NSP10, bound with NSP14, NSP10, interaction with NSP16 residues, and the envelope proteins. So as of now, we have a 16 to 17 drug targets. I'm opening now ligand profiler in your protein pharmacophore protocol and input the all your structure-based pharmacophore for screening. Click OK. And then if you have a database of pharmacophores also, you can input a database of pharmacophores. And you can select the modal selections and then most selectives you can select. I am opting for most selective option and then confirmation fast. And then you have an advanced option whether you want to screen it in a ligands or with a database. Database means you get up with the database which we created in the beginning of the session. So for 610 molecules are there. And we are going to map these components with a structure-based pharmacophores and click run. Once you click and run, I get a results like this. I'm closing this result. We get a ligand profiler results, failed confirmations. You get a fits by molecules. How many molecules are fitting with your different drug targets of SARS-CoV-2, NSP3, 8, 9, these, and then you can look it for an compounds and how it is fitting towards it. And next, by means of a pharmacophores, based on the pharmacophore conditions, what are the ligands are getting fitted towards it? That's an idea. You can see the pharmacophores, you can see the fit value. Most important interpretation in this pharmacophore is the fit value. The maximum the fit value towards a pharmacophore, the best the interactions will occur in the systems. So you can see the maximum 0.9. You can see the envelope protein is showing a 0.9 pharmacophore, 0.4 fit value with the most of the compounds. That shows it's a very good compounds will work for the envelope proteins. Going back and clicking the profiling results or click view results, you'll be getting your heat map along with your compound list. So you get a heat map. The heat map, you will see the tabular view where you have a number of compounds and the heat map will give you the best idea about the number of compounds against the various pharmacophores. You can see the various pharmacophores on x-axis and number of compounds on y-axis, and you can see the 3CLPro, it's not working with in some of these compounds, and even for PLPro, but however you can see the number of compounds are favorable for an envelope proteins and NSP14, NSP16, non-structural protein 14 and 16, and NSP13, NSP3A, because in NSP3 is a very large fragment of SARS-CoV-2, which is subdivided into A, B, C, D, E. You can see here, it is going well for this. And A, it's binding, but 3, it is not binding, C and E. So this will give me the very big overview about how many compounds are feasible in binding to the particular active site pharmacophore of a different drug target proteins, and gives me overview information about it. And of course, if you go for a docking, we don't get enough multiple, it will be taking a time consuming, but ligand profiler will save your time and also improves your results. And you can also, when you do the validation, you are preventing your results from false positives also. You can see here, once I start it out from top to bottom with the highest scores, how many ligands are arranged with the now different drug targets. This is a very easiest way and a more sophisticated way of screening your compounds with a different multiple drug targets. That's why I told you it's very applicable for a triple M model. Multiple drug targets with the multiple compounds with the multiple drug targets, pharmacophores, of course. So you can see it here. And then you can draw your conclusions. So this is how we have to. And finally, if you want to see how well it's going and binding at the site, you can pick your pharmacophore alone and then your input protein information. And then what are the fitting compounds? You can put it here and you can see how well it is interacting to one site. We didn't do any docking at all, but still you can see how to the pharmacophore features, it is mapped towards your active site of your proteins. So as you keep moving on, you can see these are the different, so drug repurposing can be very well go with this kinds of ligand profilers. So now actually this is about ligand profilers. Still I would like to go ahead with another very good topic called ADMT discrete, that's for lead optimization technique. So absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion, and toxicity. These are the very important parameters for your lead optimizations. Aqueous solubility, blood-brain barrier, and cytochrome P450, hepatotoxicity, human induced absorption, plasma protein binding. So when you have a number of compounds, here also we are dealing with a big database of compounds. So if you want to start your drug discovery process, you would like to begin from an screening from an initial ADMET toxicity process and then getting into docking and dynamics, I think this is a good start to begin with us with these protocols. So once you have a list of compounds, you have to go here and you have to create, as we shown in a previous session, you have to build the compounds databases. Once you select all those databases, you go to small molecules and the small molecules select the ADMET descriptors. Once you select the ADMET descriptors, all the models you are supposed to select, aqueous solubility, because all these models plays a major role in your screening process. So once you're done with that, you'll be getting reports. Once you see report, either way you can access from job window or double click and open the results. And you have to supposed to give every space style as be true. And then your plot has to be true. Once you give S, the plot will be open and thus gives you information about how many compounds are obeying the ADMET analysis. And this is a compound, you can see here solubility level and blood brain. Instead of interpreting with the numerical numbers, it is very easy to interpret your results by means of levels. That's why I have shown you levels. Level 3 and 2, what does it mean? Solubility for a good solubility and for medium solubility, we have a certain levels. If it is 2, it is a low. If it is 3, it is a very good solubility. And coming into blood brain barrier, we have a level 0, 1, 2 like this. If it's 1, it is a very high, and 2, it's a medium. And if you get into a CPD Y26 family, it is a very important enzyme for your metabolism activity in your liver. So whether it is binding or just making a hepatotoxicity or not, it is making a metabolism true or false. We can very easily categorize the data and we can identify the which compounds can be passed for the next level of your screening process. So now I'm going to discuss very detailedly about starting from a screening process. So you will be getting results, only three per results, ADMET S. You have the two different options here. So in the solubility screening, it predicts aqua solubility at 25 degrees Celsius and ADMET. If you are supposed to choose two different options, either S it is a good and S it is optimal, because solubility is very important parameter has to be taken in account in the drug discovery process, because it is directly inclined for your pharmacological response. You could see that in many anti-cancer drugs, the efficient therapy is hampered due to your poor solubility of your drugs. So if you increase the solubility, if you have a very good solubility, then automatically the bioavailability of drug will be improved and the disease effect and therapeutic effect also will be drastically increased. Blood-brain barrier, that's one of the very important parameter which has to be considered, because in a CNS, if you have creating a drugs for in a CNS, central nervous systems, usually there will be a lipophilic blood-brain barrier will be present. Your drug was supposed to cross that membrane in order to penetrate it. So if you have a drug, if you have a specially designing for CNS, the drug should be lipophilic in nature. So in that way, if you want to draw conclusion, see this blood-brain barrier screening will be varying for a drugs to drugs. It depends upon the views of perspectives. You can predict and pick which level you want to take. So basically, we are going for a level 0, which is for very high penetration, and 1 for the high. And it predicts a blood-brain brain-to-blood concentration after oral administration, and it also calculates a fast polar surface area, and it's atom-based log P values. And it falls under category called category levels. CPD-Y65, this is a very important enzyme. Why I'm telling this is enzyme? This enzyme is a one of the family of cytochrome P450, which is primarily expressed in the liver. And it is required for the drug metabolism. You can see this enzyme expression is mostly in the CNS area. And you see, if you take this enzyme, if it is getting inhibited, because some drugs needs this inhibition, some drugs doesn't need to be inhibition. So it basically will be going for a non-inhibition, because it's not stop your metabolism process. And you can see here the false is non-inhibitor and the true is the inhibitor. Hepatotoxicity screen, of course, if you take any drug, it should not affect your liver cells or hepatocytes, because there your metabolism enzymes, we have metabolism enzyme CP450 family of enzymes. If it's affecting your liver and making a toxicity, and it affects the overall organs is affected, then you should not take those kinds of drugs for your further analysis. That's why we are screening at the initial level of ADMET itself. Hepatotoxicity must be false. So this protocol and all this analysis has been predicted by means of machine learning algorithms using Bayesian characterization and for a category level and regression analysis using partial least square methods. The prediction, non-inhibitor and true toxic. And human, and we have another model called human intestinal absorption screening. And this predicts for your absorbed and after oral administration, and it also counts for an unknown A-log P value of an atom. It does also falls under the category levels. So 0 for good and 1 for moderate. And you'll be getting a graph like this. This graph will be explaining about an state of lipophilicity against the polar surface area, and your polar surface area must be less than 140 angstrom, because if you're having a very big halo polar surface area, it will affect your drug permeation for your cell membranes. So all these parameters we have to take in account. So finally, plasma protein binding is a very important parameter, because if you have an in the blood, we have a lot of plasma protein binding will be there. If it is going and binding with a plasma protein binding, it will affect your bioavailability also. And drug efficacy also will be affected when it bounds to it. Less bound to your drug, the more effectively it transfers to a cell membrane. That's the idea of why we are transferring for a plasma protein binding. So finally, if you have a 20,000, initially I'm going to take about 25,000 molecules, and before ADMET screening and after AMET screening, you can see only the 46 compounds are left. So with this 46 compounds, this is still considered as a hit molecules, and further optimization has to be done. So you know, we have seen only the pharmacokinetic properties. Now we are going to study the pharmacodynamic properties, which says whether after you're taking your drug, whether it is going to make you the mutagen or a cosmogen. So for that, in Discovery Studio, we have the various different animal models, which has been derived from a food drug approval and the National Toxicity Program. You can very well see here, we are having a lot of programs are available here and selected items. Available models, you want to do that. You can select here and you can upload and you can select here, you can study for it toxicity analysis. And moreover, if you want to check the which fingerprint is making the differences, that one you have to give the similarity true and detailed report true, that will give you the fingerprint informations also. This is how your ADMET toxicity results will be there. And once you run a TopCat, if you give it true, it will give you information about your compound and its basic information and what is the prediction. It is a mutagen or non-mutagen. All this TopCat information has been derived and developed by means of a technique called quantitative structure toxicity relationships. So you will get even the fingerprints, because of which fingerprint you are getting a positive results, because of which fingerprints it is going to be cosmogen. And we have a lot of fingerprints has been integrated in Discovery Studio, which helped us to identify the exact fingerprint of a molecule which is causing a cosmogenicity or mutagenicity. And also we have another options called set dosage for animal assays, because if you want to do your analysis in experimental technique, you don't know how to start, at which concentration you want to start. We have a tools for that also, which help us to identify your rat TD50 values and oral LD50 values and rat inhalation LC50 values. Even we have two different aqueous models, like a fathead minnow and then Daphne EC50 value and most TD50 value also. So all those things, you just by giving a small clicks, you'll be getting it. But however, behind it, we will be building a machine learning algorithms running all this analysis and giving us results. And once you're done with ADMET and then you finish with the TopCat, finally we are getting into drug likeness. Very important property for your oral drug administration. Basically, we follow the one rule, which is Lipinski's. Alternatively, you can combine the Weber's rules also. It is very good principle for screening your compounds, but however, it requires a large samples. If you're starting with the 2000s of molecules, of course, when we get into the drug likeness, most of the molecules will be screened out. That's why we always prefer that start from a bigger size of molecules, big database of molecules, 5 lakhs of molecules or 10 lakhs of molecules. Then only you will be finally, when you go for the further analysis, you'll be having your few hundreds to numbers. Then you can screen it and you can go for a further analysis. Now you have to select your drugs according to this formula, what the Lipinski says. How do we call it other way? So Lipinski's can be otherwise called as an RO5 violation or a Pfizer's rule of 5. He says that A log P value should be less than or equal to 5 and molecular weight should be less than or equal to 500, and they should not be, acceptor should be less than or equal to 10, and then donor should be less than or equal to 5. And put together in the Weber's tool, he states that number of rotatable bonds should be less than or equal to 10 and polar surface area, which should be less than or equal to 140 angstrom squares. Once your ligands are passing these filters, there will be higher probability of your drugs will having a good oral bioavailability. Please kindly follow these rules in your drug discovery process. These are set of prepared ligands. After doing the process, see, let us, I have started with the 25,000 and end up with only a few tens. I can count it by hand. From this two tens, when you go docking, if it is not docking, again, your process will be get filled. That's why we prefer to say that take a number of molecules in a higher amount and screen it, and then end up with a good lead. Convert your heat into lead and lead into drugs. So I'm going to show you a demonstration. So this is our Discovery Studio, and then we have the tools. We explain more about our tools and how to access and what are the utilities are in Discovery Studio and how to access it. And we have a number of tools are integrated one particular suite for a user to get benefited out of for the various protocols. You can see the various tools and various menus to edit it, and chemistry and structure and even sequence informations. Chart, if you want to draw a chart, we have various kinds of charts and scriptings and tools are there. And especially if you want to do pharmacophores and simulations and small molecules also. And finally, if you want to do this adiabatic analysis, even I'm showing in the macromolecules, we have a lot of tools which we've seen in your protein modeling and simulation, you know, during our molecule dynamic and simulation session, receptor ligand interaction for a modeling, for docking analysis, pharmacophores and small molecules. And even we have a tool especially for an X-ray crystallography data also. If you like to add your own tools, if you're working for a project, if you would like to add tools, you can add a toolbox. You can add your own tools and customize tools for your analysis. Click view tool panels and you can add it. So that will help you to keep on track of what tools are you keep on using. If you want to run adiabatic analysis, so this is the tool we explained already, dock proteins, and yesterday we saw the dock proteins and analyze the protein interfaces and all, and general purposes, and homology modeling, membrane proteins and refinements, pharmacophores and comparing receptor ligand interactions, simulations, and even for the small molecules. So now in the small molecules, I'm going to use the ADMET tools. So let me create a first number of molecules for running, and then we'll be going for an analysis. So this is job window, which job and which server location, and server location is very important when you run a CDACR also. So once only the server is connected, all your process will be done when you connect in a virtual tool room. So make sure the server is connected. So I'm taking a number of molecules. So the list of molecules I already have, you can input any formats of this in the Discovery Studio, because it is supports for various formats, various chemical formats to build your library. So you can select like this, we have an SDF format, or you can, already I built some compounds that I'm having here. So go to file and save as. You can see here how many molecules are there. If you like to remove these attributes, even you can remove the attributes also, because when you do the further analysis, there will be a lot of tabs to be created, which makes you to end up with a lot of tabs. You cannot able to interpret very easily. That's why you'll be removing the tabs at the initial level. And I'm saving the compound files in .sdf format. Save it. Sample formats or in the sample drug formats. Library. And then you can close this library. And once I have this library of compounds are with me, double click and open. I have 25,000 of molecules in this library. I'm going to screen one by one. You can screening is also very easy in this. We are going to introduce, going to give an operators based Boolean operator or operator, or giving an which equivalents to or not equivalent to. So like this, we have various operators are here, and that operators at the time you can run, or individually also you can run, and then you can see your results. So compounds are loaded. So you can see it in 2D window. How many commas are loaded, and go to protocol, ADMET, ADMET descriptors, and give the compounds all, and select the descriptors. So I'm choosing all the descriptors, and I'm going to run the process. I select all the descriptors and run the process. You can see the process is running. Almost it is done. It almost takes for 53,000 of 23,000 of molecules, only the 58 seconds it will take. You can see it in my board. So it is predicted by means of the 58 seconds. And you can open it and you can view your results. I'm closing the input and opening the output. Double click and open your results. Click here to view your results. This will help, this will open the tabular view as well as your plot views. So you have to give the plot view S. So once you click plot view S, it opens now. Click opening. You display style S. Click S. Now we can able to see your graph. You can see the very big graphs are there. I'm stopping the job. You can brief your, you can expand your things automatically. When I select the compounds in the plot, it will be highlighted automatically in your mathematic, I mean in the 3D view also. So I'm just separating just for now, because I'm going to screen, I'm going to show you parallelly how many compounds are going to get deleted. That's why I'm putting both the things side by side. So let me select first, start with an solubility level, and then I'll move on to the further levels. So if you start with the solubility level, I told you that the ADMET solubility 3 is for good and 4 is for optimal. So if I want to screen that, you can see BB level, CPD Y60 families, and what are the OP, what is the OPS? It's optimal prediction space. Any compounds which is within this OPS will obey the ADMET properties. It is a general rule to understand that. So show the legend, you get in a blood-brain barrier for 99% and 95% confident level, even for absorption, even for the ADMET ALOC-P value also. So you can look at if a lot of molecules are outside the ellipse, how to how to eliminate it by using these properties. So now you're going to sort now. The simple filter options I'm going to apply. Click on molecule, filter. Once you filter, you will be getting all these columns are displayed in your 3D, I mean a tableau view. Solubility level, I'm going to choose 3 and 4. So that shows that only those molecules should be there, so greater than or equal to 2, give name, apply, and OK. So that will sort it out, the molecules. Only 3 and 4 will be retained back, and the rest of the things will be. So once you select and delete, you can see there's a changes occurring in your plot automatically. And even the molecules also will be updated. So now my second process, I'm going for a second level of screening. Same process of screening, I'm going back. I'm sliding and going to the next level. Blood-brain barrier. So I told the blood-brain barrier 0 for high penetration and 1 for high. I'm going to fix that one. Blood-brain barrier level, click there and then select. Less than or equal to 1, name, apply, okay. Now you can, again, the changes are almost 75% to 80% of molecules are deleted when you get into blood-brain barrier levels. You can see it now here, now, parallelly in your plot also. So that shows you can, we can very well see now the compounds which is outside the ellipse are almost deleted, and the compounds which is inside the ellipse will be retained now. Now next level, CPY2D predictions equals to false, again apply, so small molecule, some molecules are being deleted. Similarly, I'm going to apply the same option for an hepatotoxicity also. You can see when only the false will be retained it, and number of cons is reduced. Next, a hepatotoxicity prediction, you can see here again filter. So if you filter even for a large number of compounds using the smart kind of technique will save your time. That's an idea of showing here. False, apply, and okay. And even if I put together, I'm going to do that process. Even you can use the same process at the time also, but in order to show you the differentiation, I'm doing one by one. So finally, you have only these many molecules. And what is the idea of here, in the sense, if you try to adjust one parameter, the other parameter will be automatically or indirectly will be adjusted, because I'm not going to touch absorptions, because absorption is being automatically done when I try to sort it out other compounds. So absorption level 0 and 1, very good absorption and moderate absorption will be totally taken care by the tools. So now this is how we have to sort it out the molecules, and these compounds we have to go for it for enough screening. So I saved this molecule's numbers after ADMET screening. I'm going to take this molecules for an top cut analysis to check whether it is having a carcinogenicity or mutagenicity or not. So list of compounds and select the models, which model you likely to study. And you have a food drug approval model and national toxicity models and multiple models is also there. And you can select here. And then as of now, I'm going to show only the one model. You will have extensible models also there where you have a multiple interactions. For a single interaction, select and click, and then okay. Even you can select for ocular retency, fat admin, or LC50, similarity search too. You can increase the number of similar compounds also, and PDF report too. That will help you to understand. If you are new to this technique, you can give true, and it will help you to understand and identify how well the fingerprints are happening. You can see the PropCat results running. It will prepare the report and then gives you results. And once it's done, click OK. And this is for one compound. Even you can give for this. We keep visible, it runs for only one compound. If you keep all, it runs for all the compounds. So click OK. So output results, detailed report. When you click detailed report, it opens the results and shows you with the non-mutagen. Why it is non-mutagen? It will try to compare the similar structures. And that also shows a non-mutagen. All these values will be recorded by previous studies, and those records have been used in Discovery Studio for building the models. And you can see very well here what are the fingerprints that have been shared for positive contribution and negative contributions also. And how many training sets has been used. Automatically, all this process running in the back end by buying a simple clicks we are getting, but we are supposed to know what is happening when you run this process. And carcinogen, why it is happening, which component and which fingerprint is contributing. So even you get those informations also when you run this. So like that, you have to predict the toxicity and you have to screen out your compounds. When you give the all compounds also, the same results will be generated. Click OK and prepare the report, you will be getting the results. It's writing the report and you are getting the results. It's running now. So make sure when you want to run in a virtual CDAC room, your server has to be connected. And then you'll be getting in the name and .cdoc.in. So you think once it's connected only, you can run all these programs. So toxicity predictions, you can run because Discovery Studio has been, we are giving all the tools and for users to predict, come out with a good lead of compounds. So now I'm showing the compounds after toxic adiamity PropCat results, you get a carcinogen and a mutagen. And here also we are going to apply a simple smart technique of introducing the filtering methods that will help me to identify which compounds are under the carcinogen or mutagen. If you click the detailed report, you'll be getting a fingerprints for 471 pages and give you detailed information, each and every compound or a fingerprint information so you can predict in Discovery Studio. And you can, if you're new to this Discovery Studio drug discovery process, you can very well learn from this software. Click here to view results and carcinogen and mutagen if you want to sort it out as like the filter method. Filter it and then select for predictions and select equals to carcinogen, non-carcinogen. And even I'm going to apply at the same time for all the results. Non-carcinogen, again a non-mutagen, like that, click apply. Identical values, okay. Even the NTP female rat, male mouse, female rat also, you can able to analyze it. Equals non-carcinogen. And in prediction, again here, male rat equals non-carcinogen. Apply and okay. Finally, with the AIMS prediction, AIMS mutagenicity, non-mutagen. Apply and then okay. So you can see here very well, only 24 molecules are retained from the 47 molecules, and I'm saving in the PropCat screened molecules in a SD format. And I'm going to use this molecules for a drug likeness screening, that is with the Lipinski's rule of 5 and Weber's rule of 5. I'm screening only with the Lipinski's, and you get this, what does the rule says, and finally they get the results. So these compounds, you can take it for in a further docking process or in a molecular dynamic and simulation, and then you can study the analysis. So this is how we have to reduce these compounds. By either you can go ahead with a structure-based pharmacophore modeling, or you can go for in a screening with an adiamic analysis. So these are the various kinds of lead optimization techniques. It's available in Discovery Studio for a user to get benefited for in a SARS-CoV-2. Thank you everyone. It's a very extensive session, but thank you everyone for watching patiently, and thank you.
Thank you, Divya. Yes, you are right. It was an extensive session, but worthwhile. It was very informative also on like screening and prioritizing the compounds. So it's a lot piece of information. So as you already know, we are shortage of time. I'll pick up just single one question, okay? While we are doing this exercise when we wanted to do a docking also, we have to do this ADMET exercise at the beginning or molecular docking screening at the beginning? Which one is your preference?
I would say that if you have a very big number of molecules and you cannot do docking, say if you have 5 lakhs and 10 lakhs of molecules, you cannot go for docking. It is a time consuming and this is a computational cost also. So if that is the case, I would prefer to say that please go ahead with the ADMET properties, screen out the compounds, and from that screen out the compounds, you will go for docking analysis. That will give you, even if you have 100% of molecules, you have, for instance, if you have 300 molecules are left out, we say that we go for a virtual screening within a lip doc and then take a few compounds and confirmations and go for C-Docker. And then from the C-Docker, you can go for a flexible docking. From the flexible docking, you can go for a molecule dynamic and simulation. That's how we have given the sessions in a workflow. You can look at from the first session till the sessions, you will be, it's like a workflow. You can follow it and you can get benefited out of it.
Okay, great. So thank you so much. Divya, Aarti, as well as Anand for joining the session. Looking forward to the next one. So thank you, everyone. Have a great evening. Bye for now.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Bye.